Izzy! Are you all right?
Damn it!
God, they're slaughtering them. Ready?
Smoke grenades. All right, let's go.
Enemy down.
Almost 5 years later, we can safely look back and say the Order 1886 was an amalgamation of design points that had the right idea, but fumbled a little in their execution. And the level design was rigid in its structure, there was little enemy variety. Boss fights amounted to simple QTEs, and the game itself was on the short side, with most playthroughs taking about 6 to 8 hours. While I don't believe that games need to be a certain length to justify cost, there's something that can be said about gamers' perception of playtime and price. And the game was chided for all its faults, and some of the criticism was definitely earned, but I give credit where credit is due. The team at Ready at Dawn worked tirelessly to build an entirely new IP from the ground up, which is a terrifying task for any developer, and I still feel that the foundation laid out in the game is absolutely worth exploring further. The world of the Order is filled with intrigue. The steampunk version of 1886 England was a breath of fresh air, a fascinating mashup of horse-drawn carriages and Victorian-style clothing and pseudo-futuristic tech, creating this captivating look into an alternate reality London. The Industrial Revolution brought with it a host of technologies far ahead of their time, like thermal imaging, zeppelins, wireless communications, and electric railguns. There's an authenticity to the state of the world, despite the fantastical changes to the history. And at the heart of this timeline lies a seemingly eternal power struggle between the world of man and the half-breeds, an outwardly monstrous mix of human and animal. And the conflict endures for centuries, and life carries on as best as it can thanks to the actions of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table around the 7th or 8th century, turning the tide of the war. Ready at Dawn created a unique universe with impeccable production values that begged to be built upon. The game combines a struggle for basic survival and fear of the unknown. There's a certain uneasy aura and sense of dread that permeates the air while playing. It's hard to explain, but you know it when you feel it. A sinister conspiracy seems to quickly foment in the background and you see it coming. Ready at Dawn's take on the characters was generally safe. You play the well-rounded, gallant knight Sir Galahad, working with the comedic jokester Lafayette and capable Lady Igraine. You have the wisest and most experienced mentor in Sir Percival. But they played well off of each other, you know, the group dynamic felt natural, drawing on a shared history between them. And the characters were well acted and the script felt mature and grounded. And the environments, while fairly linear, showcased a wonderful level of imagination and creative vision with hyper attention to detail, even though the items and knickknacks that were scattered around the levels served very little purpose, they had a funny charm to them. There was a meticulousness in giving everything a reason for existing in the world. Everything meshed together, from the weighty weapons made from rustic metal to the ingenuity of Nikola Tesla's gizmos. Everything had its place within the context of the world.
Essex M86, thermite rifle. They saw their first field action a few weeks ago. How did the rebels get their hands on these?
I'm making it my business to find out.
Some encounters admittedly felt bare bones, amounting to little more than staying in the same spot against an enemy or tackling some QTEs, but all of that was a clear indication of time constraints getting the better of a project in development. Combat itself, which involved shooting, maneuvering through the environment, and taking cover, all felt really good, like a proper third-person shooter should. Guns carried a certain heft that was felt through the process of taking aim and popping off rounds with the shotgun or Fauchian auto rifle or devastating arc induction lance. Ready at Dawn nailed the messy brutality and intensity of gunfights. The plot itself grew increasingly darker as you played through each chapter, like an ominous dark cloud drawing closer. The motives and secrets of important characters were revealed at a tense but steady pace, ultimately culminating in a global conspiracy with lycans and vampires vying to spread their kind to the Americas and beyond through unscrupulous means. And the saddest part about all of this is there's a great story here. It's really good, and the world concept was refreshingly unique. The visuals were drop-dead gorgeous, the combat was pretty well refined. It could use some improvements, but you know, it was good. The soundtrack was suitably dark and sinister. Production values were just through the roof. It still holds up today. I mean, honestly, it's still one of the best looking games on the PS4, bar none. And the ending, you know, the ending remains one of the most ardent conclusions to a game this generation, in my opinion, showing two brothers of knighthood just filled with regret to where everything had ended. You see, it's not the fumbled execution and end result of the Order 1886 that begs for a sequel, but the capacity of the IP to develop into something special. It had all the hallmarks of growth potential, from its unique premise and richly detailed world to gameplay and mechanical improvements that were pretty straightforward to suggest. Games like Assassin's Creed 2 and Killzone 2 prove that an IP doesn't have to be hindered by its first impression. There's a lot there that can be salvaged. It's so unfortunate that what I can only assume were time constraints and significant efforts made to develop the engine technology from scratch that got in the way of crafting a truly top-tier IP launch for the team. I mean, this was their very first attempt at a new IP, but it wasn't like Ready at Dawn hadn't had the talent to create wonderful games. I mean, their PSP releases like Daxter and God of War Chains of Olympus and Ghost of Sparta were some of the absolute best games I'd played on that platform. It's almost hard to put into words just how much blood and sweat and tears goes into building an entirely new universe from the ground up. With the engine technology already in place, a significant amount of work could actually go into the gameplay design of subsequent games in the Order IP, and it's a shame to watch all that effort go down the drain, particularly for a universe as curious and as compelling as that of the Order 1886.
I'll join you shortly. And don't you know, I'm Galahad.